wonders of your heart.
Ooh. Hey, good morning, everybody. Let's go ahead and stand up. We'll go ahead and start. Our countdown went crazy. Hey, happy 2021. It's so good to see all of you. All right, let's put our hands together.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Father, we're so thankful. Thankful that we can be together. Although in many ways we're all around the world, not just Renew, but churches that honor Christ together today, declaring that you are worthy. And I pray for those that have made a New Year's resolution to be more consistent in worship. I pray that today is the beginning of something great, and not just something to get worn out with by February, but instead that this is a vital part of life, to come together, whether we're in this room or spread out across the globe, hopefully in our living rooms with friends and family or neighbors, and hear the same, that we can come together and worship. And so help us to see in our lives, our daily lives, that your promises are true. Help us to walk in those and live in those and to trust you in a world that seems completely upside down. So help us to strive to follow, to be consistent in you every day, not just on a Sunday. And so, Father, I pray today that you open blind eyes that they will see, deaf ears that they will hear. And I pray that no distraction will take us out. We can be fully present in you. So thank you, Father, for what you've already done in this time of worship. And now as we continue to worship in the word and communion and offering and all those things, I pray that we will celebrate you in all of it. And so, Father, thank you for today. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. You can have a seat.
All right. So if you are a kiddo, now it's your time during the service. I want you to look at either side of the screen. And while you're doing that, you'll get to... This is your lesson for today. If you haven't already, make sure that you grab a pack from the kids' table out front, parents, for your kiddo. So kiddos, go ahead and pay attention right now.
God's story, the Sermon on the Mount. So part of God's story is about a sermon Jesus gave on the side of a mountain and what he did afterwards. And it goes like this. One day, when Jesus saw crowds gathering to hear him teach or see him do miracles, he went to the side of a mountain. It was near the Sea of Galilee, across from a place called Capernaum. From there, he gave a message all about God's kingdom and his love. We call this message the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus started by explaining who would get blessings or favor from God. He said the most blessed people are those who are poor, sad, or humble. He said God shows favor to people who are just or treat others fairly, and people who are merciful or show love to those who don't deserve it. He said the people who are pure, who bring peace, or who get hurt for doing right will be rewarded for their actions in heaven. In other words, the people who love others, even when it makes them seem weak or unimportant on earth, are like heroes in God's kingdom. Anyway, Jesus went on to explain that when we believe in and follow him, it's our job to show everyone else who he is by loving them. That means going out of our way not only to comfort and help our friends, but also forgive people who hurt us, love our enemies, and give to people in need. The thing is, Jesus didn't just talk about love, he showed it all the time. In fact, right after giving this sermon, Jesus spent the rest of the day helping everyone he met. First, as Jesus came down from the mountain, a man with a skin disease called leprosy knelt before him. "Lord," the man said, "if you are willing, you can heal me and make me clean." Usually, no one wanted to be around people with leprosy, but Jesus touched him and said, "I am willing. Be healed." Instantly, the leprosy disappeared. Then, when Jesus arrived in Capernaum a bit later, a soldier said to him, "Lord, my servant is in terrible pain." Right away, Jesus said, "I will come and heal him." The officer said, "Just say the word from where you are, and my servant will be healed." Jesus told him, "Because you believed, it has happened." The officer's servant was healed. A little later, Jesus arrived at his disciple Peter's house. Peter's mother-in-law was there too, sick in bed with a high fever. Jesus touched her hand, and the fever left. Later that evening, many other people who were demon-possessed or sick came to see Jesus. He brought relief to all of them. At the end of the day, Jesus got into a boat with his disciples. Suddenly, A fierce storm came out of nowhere. Waves began crashing into the boat. The disciples realized that even though they were in the middle of a giant storm, Jesus was fast asleep. They shouted, "Lord, save us! We're going to drown!" Jesus said, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" Then he told the wind and waves to stop. They did. That day, Jesus taught a lot of people how to love and showed them what love looks like. Whenever somebody took their sickness or pain or fear to Jesus, he helped them. Everybody who met Jesus got to experience his love. And when we love like Jesus, everyone who meets us can feel his love too. And that's the story of the Sermon on the Mount. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Crowds gathered. Jesus went to a mountain. He gave a sermon. He talked about God's kingdom. He told us how to love others. Jesus didn't just talk about love. He showed it. He healed sick people. He saved people who were demon-possessed. He calmed storms. He showed his love to everyone he met. Our job is to do that too. And that's a part of God's story.
Good morning, my friends. I'm Spencer Dunlap. If you don't know me, I'm the founding pastor here at Renew. And as we kick off the year, you know, I've always, we've been at this 10 years together, which is really 10 years this month for my family and I to be in this city and doing this work. And of course, in the summertime, we'll officially celebrate our 10-year anniversary. But I almost never preach right after Christmas. I've, for all this time, taken that time off. And so today I wanted to invite my friend Michael Brown. And Michael's a church planter also, and they got started a little bit behind us, but up in Fayetteville. And so as he's had time free, I've wanted him to come down and be able to share some things with you. And I think he'll even maybe mention some of that a little bit about what's going on with the church in Fayetteville. And so I'm very thankful for that. So I'm going to hand it off to him, but thank you again. And Michael, it's all yours.
All right. Thanks, Spencer. It's awesome to be with you all again. I'm going to pray, and we are going to jump in, and we're going to be in Acts chapter 1 for a lot of this morning. God, thank you so much for the morning. I thank you for this church. I thank you for all that Renew has done for the community here in Cabot. I thank you for being your light here. Lord, I thank you for everyone that's coming together to worship, to kick off this new year in the right way, and I pray that it continues moving forward, that our hearts are right with you and our actions follow. God, you're a good God. As we jump into your word this morning, will you help us to never be the same again as we learn more about who you are and, gosh, and how amazing you are and how much you love us and what it looks like to participate in your kingdom and be on mission. It's in your son's holy name we pray. Amen. I'll tell you what. It's kind of odd being here in service 2021, worshiping together. It throws me off. I'm a little off my game, but it's absolutely incredible in the middle of all this time to be here. And for us, New Year's Eve and then New Year's Day, I don't know what it was like for you all, but I used to be like the tradition. I want to watch the ball drop, and I hate black eyed peas, but my family hails from Texas originally. My wife's like, you're not a Texan, but that's where I was born, and so therefore I am. And so I eat one black eyed pea a year. Not this year. This year I said no. This year I'm saying the traditions did not get us where we needed to be, therefore I don't want to follow them. We made homemade pizza. It was excellent. Oh my goodness. Getting here, it's like, I'm a big soccer guy, all right? Like, any soccer fans in here? There's always three or four really amazing people in a room. All right. I feel like, and just for you three or four, not anyone else, when you get a participation trophy after a losing season and they hand it to you or they hand it to your kids, and you're like, I don't know what to do with this. I kind of feel like we just got the participation trophy for getting to 2021. And it's like this kind of garbage feeling. And then also then the cross of like scaling a 14er. Any hikers in the room? Or people that aspire to climb a mountain one day? It's like that blend of, yeah, it's that blend of the participation trophy for losing season and scaling a 14er, and here we are. And so I'm in this weird spot right now. Like, we have had our worlds turned upside down in 2020. Some things outside of our control, and some things that were within our control and how we responded. And so my question is, how do we right our upside down world? Spencer mentioned, yeah, prayer. Spencer mentioned, we planted a church. My bride is here with me today, and we planted a church, gosh, about 7 or 8 years ago in Fayetteville, and COVID and the challenges changed what we do, and we are now a house church meeting once a month as a service, and it's been this massive shift that we have undergone, and I'll tell you what, I absolutely love it, but it's been a wild time in the fall. I like it too, though. It lets me come down and hang out with you all. We're getting ready to work through the book of Acts, and as we've been getting ready for Thrive to work through it, I'm like, that's how I'm starting the year with you all. The story about the start of the church. It's incredible. It's a story of fresh starts, new starts, a story of being renewed, a story of something that I've glossed over too many times. But for the past few weeks, I've been meditating on it, processing it, and I'm seeing what I've missed all these years. So let me set the stage for you. When we get to Acts 1, Jesus has been, he's done his ministry. He's walked with his apostles and the disciples for about 3 years. He's done miracles. He's taught about his kingdom, and then he's been crucified, and he's risen again, and he's not just yet ascended as we get into Acts chapter 1. So it's this interesting time when everything's about to shift. In the middle of all that, I'm sure they all remember sitting around the room during the Last Supper, realizing that Judas is the one, their friend that they've been hanging out with for years, doing ministry with, the one who's been taking care of the money, betrayed them. And not only did he betray them, but then he goes and he buys a field and he commits suicide and he's gone. The heartache, the pain. They couldn't make anything right. I'm sure some of them in the middle of the anger are like, well, what if I could have? What if I would have? What if I would have said? What if I would have had one more like loaf of bread with Judas that one time? Jesus. He's with the apostles off and on during a 40-day period, and they're confused. They're confused. Because everything that they thought was going to happen as they followed Jesus didn't. I don't know if you can relate to that. They thought 32 AD was going to be their year. The Roman Empire would no longer control them. The emperor would be forced to leave. The Jewish nation would again rise up, but this time Christ's followers and the apostles who were walking with Jesus would be ruling the show. Maybe their faces would be on the money that's being used. They're going to have a sweet office with a mahogany desk. Like, they're going to be the ones. They thought the kingdom of Israel was going to rise up, and they were going to be in power. I'll tell you what, I don't feel like that's too far off from some of us. I mean, I thought 2020 was going to be our year. I don't know about like our year collectively, but our year as a family, I thought this was going to be it. The goals were set. Like, we are ready to rock and roll and set up for an even bigger 2021. And then things outside of our control impacted our world. And things outside the apostles' control impacted their world, and their leader was leaving them. Oh man, like, back in March, I wish I would have been reading Acts 1. I always skipped to, like, the day of Pentecost. You know, the typical, like, Acts 4, Acts 2 stuff, the church meeting together, gathering together, praying together, like, that stuff. But, oh my goodness, like, why didn't I go to Acts 1? The apostles, they had their worlds turned upside down, and everything they thought was no longer. What they thought was going to happen wasn't happening, and they were absolutely confused about what was going to happen. And all they had moving forward was the words of Jesus. All they had after the ascension was trusting in and following the words of Jesus. I don't mean that in some Sunday school answer type thing with a flannel graph. I'm literally saying they were with Jesus. Jesus talked to them, gave them direction. They remembered the teachings of Jesus when they were with him for 3 years in the ministry. All they had literally were the words of Jesus. Do this, do this, do this. The apostles, the disciples, they were confused, they were scared, they were frustrated, they were in a world of unknown. They did not know what was about to happen. But check this out, Acts 1, 1 through 11, it's up on the screen, it's a lot of scripture, and I just think we need to check it out this morning. I'll try and read slow, you can read slow, we can have fun. I will say this. I had an Acts class at Ozark Christian College. My professor was Harvey Backus, and so he made us memorize this all the time. And so, like, when I read this verse 1, I think of him, and it's like that 8 o'clock in the morning college feeling of exhaustion every time I read this verse 1. It's getting real with you. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach, until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit, so the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command. Listen, this is when he tells them what to do. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? We need to hold on to that for a second, because Jesus has been talking to them about the kingdom of God. And he says, don't leave Jerusalem. You're baptized with water. It's about to be the Holy Spirit. And they're like, Jesus, is it going to happen? You're going to restore the kingdom of Israel now. And he said to them, I'm sure he's so patient. He said, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. That's the ascension. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed white stood beside them, men of Galilee. They said, "Why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven, he will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." All right, check this out. I want you to process this with me. Jesus had been with them talking about the kingdom. He gives them instruction. And they said, "Hey, Jesus, is this the time the kingdom of Israel is going to happen? All that we've been waiting for." I want us to grab this reality that they misunderstood the kingdom. They misunderstood the kingdom. They said, "When will the kingdom of Israel be restored?" Jesus is talking about something bigger, the kingdom of God. Jesus was establishing something much bigger and better than what they could have thought or imagined. And we, as a church now, I'm not saying just Renew, I'm talking about like Christians, followers of Christ. We need to get kingdom. When we have a better picture of the kingdom of God, I think it's much easier for us to participate in the kingdom rather than trying to establish our own. Not understanding the kingdom is what has led to so much chaos and disarray. It's why the apostles needed some more, and it's why we need some more. Here's what they were expecting. It's what they thought the kingdom was. What they thought was going to happen was the emperor was going to be overthrown, or at the minimum, his power would be pulled back from where it was. That literally their city, their nation, would rise up again. New kingdom, new army, new rules, new faces on the money, new government, new power structure, with the apostles leading the charge. When is that going to happen, Jesus? When will the right people be the ones leading? Well, what was Jesus talking about? He's talking about something much different. Jesus isn't so much interested in overthrowing the Roman Empire or who is the emperor. I think God cares. But I think he cares about something bigger. And I think we should too. Jesus spoke about the kingdom often. It's clear his disciples didn't get it. But what Jesus is inviting them into is also what Jesus invites us into. Megan, my wife of many years, I think like 16, 17, 18, something like that. I've been dating her for 20. It's all the same. She does a ridiculous amount of research now and writing in her blog called When Farm Girl Meets City Boy. At first, I was like, "I'm not a city boy." And I'll tell you what, this is the first non-flannel shirt I've worn in like 6 months. She bought it for me for Christmas. Super soft. So I think that proves I'm a city boy. So she writes on this. I'm going to share a little bit about what she has taught me. And if you look up that blog, you can read much more on the kingdom. Because I think we need to understand the kingdom. When we learn that the kingdom grows. In Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 32, I want us to grab this. This is stuff that Jesus was teaching his disciples, and over, they still didn't get it, even after his death and burial, even after he resurrected from the dead, they were still confused. But in Mark 4, 26 through 32, he said this. I love hearing the pages move back and forth. I love that the church is reading the Bible. He said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain. First the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come. Again he said, what shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed you plant in the ground. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds of the air can perch in its shade. We learn that the kingdom grows. It's not stagnant. It's not dead. It grows. We don't always know exactly how it grows. The seed scatters. It sprouts up everywhere. And then it branches out, kind of like the church. The kingdom grows. We also see that the kingdom is spiritual. It's like another realm. John 18:36. Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders, but now my kingdom is from another place. It's not about government power. It's not about whose face is on the money. It's not about whether they're small individual kingdoms. It is about God's kingdom. And what's so amazing is that Jesus is establishing his kingdom on earth, and the apostles getting ready to make it happen are so confused by it. They're confused. Jesus says, go stay in Jerusalem. Like, are you going to do your kingdom thing now, Jesus? Because we're ready. We've been walking around a lot. And I think Jesus had to say what he said because he's like, you'll be walking a lot more in a little while. It's going to get harder. I'm just going to just go to Jerusalem. Megan wrote a little bit of what I want to read to you here. The kingdom is expanding, and so how does it expand? We tell people about it. We share about who Jesus is. We tell stories about how Jesus has loved us, what he did upon the cross for us. It starts small when we share, but can you imagine if each of us just shared the gospel with two people in our lifetimes? I hope we do more than that. And they in turn told two more. That small contribution creates a butterfly effect that can affect an entire nation in a matter of a year, a decade, and before you know it, something resembling a tree appears in front of you. It keeps on branching out, branching out, branching out. It is constantly growing. Jesus in Matthew 13 compares the kingdom to yeast that grows three parts of flour. That's 22 kilos worth, enough to feed 300 people. He also described it like a person finding a hidden treasure in a field. They immediately sold everything to buy the entire field just to have the treasure. Sounds like when you find the kingdom, you'll do anything to keep experiencing it. The apostles were being set up to experience the kingdom, to expand the kingdom, to participate in the kingdom, but they didn't get it. I think the same is true for us. We're constantly invited to participate in the kingdom, but for some reason, we miss it. We live frazzled, chaotic lives, and we forget about what's right in front of us. That's why I wish I would have been in Acts 1 back in March when everything was turned upside down. Because while the apostles were confused and while they didn't really know exactly what they were doing and they didn't really know exactly what was about to happen, they did set a good example for us. Without having the full plan, without knowing how everything was going to work, without knowing the details, you know what? They had the words of Jesus. Jesus said, stay in Jerusalem. You'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Like, stop asking about the kingdom of Israel. you will receive my power. Acts 1, 12 through 26. I'm just going to keep this going for a little bit. Then they returned to Jerusalem over the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women, and Mary, and mother of Jesus, is with his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through the mouth of David concerning Judas, who served as a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in this ministry." I want you to catch this. Their leader is now ascended. All they have are his words and scripture. Peter stands up and he goes, "Remember what scripture says." It wasn't, let's double check this Roman decree that came out last week. It wasn't, "Did you hear how terrifying it will be? Do you hear how these people don't like us?" No, it's, "Remember the scriptures." I'm going to skip down. Verse 20, as it talks about Judas dying there and committing suicide. Verse 20, it says, "For said Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place of leadership.' Therefore, it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So they proposed two men, Joseph called Barsabbas, also known as Justice, it's a cool name, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. So is which of these two you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry which Judas left to go where he belongs?" Then they cast lots. They played like a version of paper, rock, scissors, drew straws, whatever you want to call it. Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias, and so he was added to the 11 apostles. That doesn't mean Justus left in a fit to go start his own little like upper room ministry. It just means he wasn't one of the 12. I'm sure he was still there participating in the mission, even though his name wasn't one of the 12. They were all frustrated, though. They're all scared. They're all kind of angry about what Jesus did. And Peter essentially said, "Hey, who's going to be our 12th man?" And they figured it out. Let me make sure I'm connecting this for you. When their world was turned upside down, when everything that they thought was going to happen wasn't going to, when everything that they thought was going to happen didn't happen, not only did it not happen, but it's not going to happen the next year just because you have a black-eyed pea. God had a different plan. The disciples missed it. When their world was turned upside down, it's so simple, but it's so important, okay? They looked to Scripture and followed. This is what Scripture said. This is what Jesus said. When what they thought was no longer, in a room of 120, I think we have more than 120 in this room right now. I would venture to guess there are a lot of control freaks in this room, not just the one standing on this rug. All right? Can you imagine the people who are like goal-oriented, and they've already got like, here's what we're going to do, and here's the mountain we're going to conquer, and here's the strategy of how it's going to happen. Jesus is getting in the way. And then there's the people who are just so nervous about how everyone's going to feel and how what everyone's thinking, and is everyone together, and is Justice's feelings hurt after he lost rock, paper, scissors? And then there's the like the analytical thinkers, and it's like, if we're not going to do what all the things we thought was going to happen, what are we going to do? And yet they're all there in one room, all these different personalities, all this different behavior, all these different elements of trauma in their world, all together in one place. And none of their process or plans or goals, like none of it was going to fix everything. And so they all swallowed their pride, submitted to Jesus, and followed suit. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. I'll tell you what. Because when you read on, if you're like, I don't know the story of Acts 2, I don't know what Michael's talking about, then just like ignore what I'm saying and go ahead and keep reading it. Like it's the first sermon. And after that, then the church begins. More people like realize who Jesus is, they're baptized, and the church begins. It's the start of the church. I think God had a plan. He was setting up something more important than a kingdom with a government and with the right pictures on the money. He was setting up his spiritual kingdom and inviting everyone to participate in it. And it's going to grow. That's how you scatter the seed. And then it sprouts up. And then it branches off. And this one over here, it sprouts up and then it branches off. And we see all through the book of Acts how the church has started. And there's a church in this region, a church in this town, a church in this part of the city, a church. The church began. The disciples, everyone in that room, the apostles, the 12, they listened to Jesus. They listened to Jesus, and God worked in incredible ways as his followers were in unity together. How were they in unity? They listened to Jesus. It wasn't, well, my grandma said this, or my third cousin's brother said this. Well, I read this in the tabloid this week. Well, I can't believe the church would do this. I mean, our church, Thrive, looks very different than your church here, but yet we have unity. Why? We're part of the kingdom. We're all listening to Jesus. When their world was turned upside down, they looked to Scripture and followed. And I'm sure some of them were like, well, we have to support our families. Maybe I should just go back to work. I was a good fisherman. I was a great tax collector. I could start rolling in it, bankroll this thing. We have to eat. It doesn't make sense to stand here in this room waiting. Like, we don't know when the Holy Spirit's coming. We don't even know what that means. And we don't know what happens after. But Jesus said. And I'm sure some of them in the room are like, I don't know. Maybe we should try what Jesus said. Because Jesus, in all of his years with them, never let them down. In all of his years with them, he never led them astray. In all of his years with them, he never broke a promise. In all of his years with them, they went through hard things, but there were blessings on the other side. Just not the blessings they all expected. Like, let's trust Jesus. And let's see what this Holy Spirit is all about. It was hard for them to wrap their minds around how to do it, as it is for us. It's hard when we have our mindset on our own kingdoms, our own lives, to trust His words, to focus on His kingdom, to listen to His words, to His direction, and we follow. I wonder what it looks like, what it means to be out of control and let Him be in control. Because the kingdom of God is growing, and the kingdom of God is here, and we are all invited to participate in it. As Spencer says, now what? I don't want to make this too complicated. I wear soft shirts. I'm not that intelligent. When you don't know what to do, do what honors God. Well, how do I do that? How do we honor God? Well, through our relationships, right? Through the community that God has put us in. Well, let's start simple. How do I honor God in the way that I'm a parent? How do I honor God if you're in the way that I respond to my parents, even when I don't understand them? How do I honor God? How do I honor my wife? It's not just about, like, respecting my wife. It's about honoring my wife. It's not just about respecting the words of God. It's about honoring God. So maybe as we try and figure out, well, what does Jesus say? I think a lot of times we know. This is not something Jesus would really want. But I'm on that line. It's going to work out. It's going to be okay because I'm me. Maybe. But is that honoring? Is that submitting? Is that staying in the upper room until Jesus says the Holy Spirit's coming? Like, I don't think it is. I don't think it is. And so as we consider what it means to participate in His kingdom, if you are a Christ follower, I want you to think about it. If you are you honoring God in your relationships at home? Are you honoring God in your relationships at work? Are you honoring God in your relationships with your friends, with your family? I think that's where we start. And I think we see God work through the Holy Spirit in us in some incredible ways that maybe you didn't quite understand before because we overcomplicate this stuff. We don't need to. See, they were waiting for the Holy Spirit, but if we're Christ followers, we have the Holy Spirit in us already, giving us power to live this out even when it's hard. And so I say, let's do it. We don't need a black-eyed pea to help us. If you like those, then eat them. The sweetened cornbread I'm in on. But in all of that, back in March when all this hit and all the chaos and all the disarray, all of us being frazzled, all of us being confused. Man, I wish I would have just read this. Let's do what Jesus said. Let's give that a shot. In just a moment, I'm going to pray, and then there's the tables around the room where you can go and take communion. And the Holy Spirit works and is constantly kind of bringing us back and helping us see in a new way. And I want you to process as you take communion this morning that represents His broken body and His shed blood and the fact that we have salvation and redemption with Him. I want you to process for a moment, like, God, what are you saying to me? What are you saying to me? What are you revealing to me? How can I honor you? How can I follow your words, your direction, your will in each and every aspect of my life? And that is worship. And I pray we worship right now. We worship through music. We worship through communion. And we worship when we walk out these doors in just a little while. Will you all stand with me and pray? God, you are a good God. You are faithfully, like you love us, you are with us, you are for us, and you invite us to participate in your kingdom. And you put people in our path each and every day when we go home and when we go to work, when we see our friends, whether in person or on Zoom. Lord, will you help us in those moments, the places where you've already put us to be your light. To look at what it means to participate in your kingdom in every aspect of our life. To listen to your words and to follow. It's in your Son's majestic and holy name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will see of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father.
Father, I pray that we will sing of that tomorrow and the next day and the next day, that we don't only sing about it when we're together in this place, but instead this is the condition of our heart, a position of worship always. So I pray that you will grow that in us more and more. And so Father, I pray today for people watching all over the world that the result is the same, that our lives are continually transformed as our minds are renewed. And that every day, every one of us will look to just see what you've had to say. So many people, Father, I've heard over the years have said that you're silent, and yet their Bibles remain closed. You have spoken. Help us to seek it. Help us to see what it has to say. You don't need a seminary degree to do it. And Father, I pray that you will remind every Christian that they don't need a seminary degree to open their Bible. They just need to open it and begin. And that your Holy Spirit will lead them where they need to go. And for those that aren't sure about any of this, that are just curious, and maybe even annoyed by it, I pray that you will meet them right there and that you will drive them to open their Bibles. Maybe right to Acts chapter 1. And just see what it is that you have to say. So, Father, I pray that you will bring these things to our memory, that we will remember this message, these scriptures, and that it will impact the way we live our lives, because we, even though it's 2021, still live in a chaotic world. So, Father, lead us that way. Help our lives to be transformed, even now as we go from this place, to be different than when we came. Thank you, Father, for what you've done here. Thank you for what you are about to do. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. You can have a seat.
When I was 16 and had my first job, my dad taught me to tithe. I didn't completely understand what tithing was, and I didn't make much working in fast food, but I started small. Slowly, I began trying to one-up myself. I used to tell my dad how much I gave each week, and this rush of excitement came over me. And that sense of excitement to give and to tithe was written onto my heart, and it's still with me today as an adult. Now, I was entrusted with only a little money at a young age, and in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12, Jesus tells us the story of the old woman in the temple who gave two small copper coins in the offering. It wasn't much, but it was all she had. What that story teaches us, and what was taught to me when I was 16, was when we give, not just because the Bible tells us to, but because we want to, it births a spirit of freedom and generosity in our hearts the world cannot understand. Generosity is not a one-time compulsion. Generosity is a lifestyle. When we give more, somehow God gives us more. Not more than what we earned, but more responsibility and focus on what is truly important. What happens is we begin to let go and spend less money on what is not important and save more money so we are ready to spend on what is most important. And oftentimes, that's giving it to others instead of holding on to it. The Bible commands us to give because God knows how money can hold our hearts captive, and His desire is to be the one desire of our hearts.
All right, let's pray together. God, thank you so much for the way you have provided. Even this week, we saw something beautiful, and you have blessed us in amazing ways, and I'm so thankful that we've been able to continue to do the work that you've called us to do in this crazy season. It is sad, and my heart breaks for the churches that have had to shut their doors because they didn't have the money to keep going and couldn't pay a mortgage or an electric bill. And so, Father, we're thankful and humbled that we have been able to. And so I pray that we'll trust you. I pray that I will trust you with those things. And I pray that every one of us will. But I also pray that we won't just talk about how good it is for those things to be taken care of, but instead that you will remind us that it's us that you call into action. And you always provide somehow in some way, but you call your people to do it. Just as you call us into action to go share the good news with people, you call us into action even to give our, yes, time and our talents and our treasures. So I pray that this year is a new beginning for all of that, that we will trust you in all of that. And so we look forward to seeing what you do with all of that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, I have a celebration I want to talk about on the offering real quick, and that is, oh, by the way, there's also ways to give. This week, we had somebody that had a huge financial blessing, and they blessed Renew with it, and it was one of those things where November, December was really tough.
But God.
And there at the last minute, things came through to be able to take care of it, and it was just one of those amazing things.
So, I celebrate that.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. So as you're praying, the word like participation is just going through my brain, like participation, because we have felt like we haven't been able to participate much in things since COVID. I mean, we can only have a certain amount of people in to serve, and we can only have, but you're right. Like that's one of the ways that my family participates in serving Renew is making sure that they're in, the finances are here to get shoes and to serve people in the name of Jesus. So if you feel like you're not able to participate because you can't physically be here, it's just, it's another way to serve.
Absolutely.
It's good.
Good. Okay. Well, I sidetracked you. So welcome. Good morning.
Welcome. I'm Irish. Good morning. My name is Dixie Harden. I'm on staff here at Renew. I'm not actually Irish, in case you couldn't tell. Okay, if you are a guest, let me be the first to welcome you. I'm so glad that you are here, and I would ask that you please stop by the welcome desk on your way out, so that way we get to know you and your family a little bit more. If you're a guest online, I would like you to follow the link that's being dropped right now. Fill out your Guest Connect card there, please. Okay, celebration time.
Yes.
There's only one. Oh, well, you had a great celebration. That was beautiful.
I know. That was beautiful. Really good.
His birthday was the other day. Did you guys know that?
Yeah.
I did it for the first year. I made a sappy post about my friend.
It was
so you're so nice. I really like you. But I really hope that you had a great birthday.
Yes, it was good.
And we had Lunchbox Connection all week and the week before. And so I'm going to let you look at some of the slides that go through. Look at those. Look, it almost looks like they're standing next to each other, but they weren't. Yeah. There's Tracy. Mm-hmm.
Just looks like they're standing next to each
other. But hold on. 3,310 meals is what went out the door here. And you guys wonder why you're tired. It's like such a blessing. We had partners like Taco Bell. Thank you so much, Tracy.
Yes.
We had partners like Pizza Pro, and I don't want to forget, but I know that there was somebody else. United Methodist Church, who I love so much. Yeah, so. And then all of you guys come through so hardcore with all of the lunch items, so thank you so much. We actually had some left over to put back for spring break, so good job.
Yes.
That is my celebration. We get to take a couple months off, and then March we'll be doing it again while the kiddos go on spring break. So look for that. We'll do the sign-ups the exact same way that we did them this time, which is you sign up your family, and that's how you do it.
Yeah.
You can't just show up anymore.
Right. That's perfect. Okay, so we have a couple things. One is giving statements are going to go out this week. And so
let's call them participation statements.
And so they're participation. We're on that participation thing. And so there's a link online. And so even for those of you that are watching in here, if you go to the Renew page and this day, you can find it. There's a link there to update your information. And so even if you're not new to Renew, it wouldn't hurt to go in and just make sure your address is right. Because every year we get about 25 back or more than that sometimes.
That's like $10.
Yeah, right. Stamps. So go in and just make sure that your email address is right. Make sure that your address is right. That kind of stuff. That way when we send them out, we'll actually have the right addresses.
Yeah.
And of course, again, if you're a guest, we'd love for you to jump in there and do that as well. There's two different links for that. That's all I got.
Okay. Last thing is, if you have a kiddo who is 8th through 12th grade, Remix is back on this week, and they're going to do a country fried night. Yeah. I'm going to try my best to explain this. I think that you wear overalls and a straw hat. Is that right? Yeah? Who's country in here? Chris is right there. Okay. No, you guys know. Y'all live in Arkansas. So wear something that looks like country, and they're going to join together. You guys make sure to wear your masks and be there at the door at 6:15 for you guys to come in and enjoy your time together. Remix has been so awesome since they've been back together. Keep going. Keep going this year. Okay.
Yep. All right.
That's all
let's stand up. We're going to pray together. We love you. We're thankful for you. Keep coming. Keep participating in what we're doing here. So, Father, thank you for today. Thank you for Michael and his willingness to come and share. We're thankful that for a worship team is willing to enter into your throne room and invite us along. I'm thankful that we can come and we can give and commune and grow. Help us to never just be participants of the work that's on the stage, though. Instead, that we're not just watching other people do it, but instead, we are participants in the kingdom. Every day that we are going after it, that we were sharing the good news of Christ with our neighbors, our friends, our family, our kids, especially our kids, and anywhere we go. I pray that your kingdom will grow and expand, and that we will remember that the Holy Spirit that lives inside of the believer gives us the power still to be your witnesses, not just in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth, but in Cabot, in Jacksonville, Sherwood, Beebe, Austin, Ward, Lone Oak County, Pulaski County, Arkansas, the United States, and the rest of the world. Help us to know that this is not just some person's responsibility, but it is every Christian. Amen. To go out and share the good news. Help us to want to do it and love it. Thank you, Father, for this time. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, my friends. Hey, if you could look around, if you got trash around your chairs, like community cups and stuff, grab it on your way out. We're going to open up the door here in the lobby, and we'll see you soon.
Bye-bye. Bye. My heart is wavering.